Thank you, Proactive, for hosting us today, and thank you for that great introduction. Great. So while you read the forward-looking statement, I just want to point out the picture. That is a simulator, a truck simulator in Burkina Faso, and I'm always amazed where people with no previous driving experience several months later are able to drive big trucks at one of our mines. So we've divided the presentation into four sections. First, a quick snapshot of who we are. Second, I mean, mining is all like real estate. It's all about where you are. So we'll focus why we think West Africa is a great place to be. We'll talk about our strategy. And then finally, if I told you a great story up until now, we'll try to convince you of why to invest in Endeavour afterwards. So who are we? As you would have heard from that introduction, we are now listed. It's been a year now in London. On the big board, a premium segment LSE, and in Toronto, we are the largest gold producer in West Africa. And again, we'll talk about why West Africa is a great place to be. Overall, we produce about 1.4 million ounces at very low cost. In fact, compared to the senior peer group, we're one of the lowest cost producers. This year, we expect to be less than $900 per ounce. We have six mines across the region in Senegal, Ivory Coast, and Burkina Faso. So what we offer immediate cash flow from our six producing assets. We have healthy competition for growth with six projects within our portfolio at various stages. And we have the largest exploration package in West Africa. So overall, the three different pillars in our business are working towards hitting a 20% return on capital employed target. On project side, we're looking at over 20% IRRs at conservative gold prices of 1300. And on the exploration side, we're seeking to discover, you'll see up to 20 million ounces at less than $25 per ounce. So what's the golden opportunity we see in West Africa? Before we turn, I mean, this is not in the US or in Europe. This is the six-lane highway out of Abidjan, capital of Ivory Coast. So you see that in contrary to what people think, I mean, it's very well developed in West Africa. So on the mining side, it's been one of the fastest growing gold producing regions globally. You see on the chart here that it's grown by over 90% in the last decade. Traditionally, gold production came from what you see in yellow, so that's Ghana. The growth has come obviously from Ghana, but more so from Burkina Faso, Mali, Ivory Coast, and Senegal. So those are countries in which we're not only present in fact, we're the largest gold producer in each of these countries. I think this is an interesting slide. I'll just pause here and really focus because it's important to realize where gold production comes from today. So if you're a gold producer or a gold investor, I mean, you basically have China, West Africa, Russia, Australia, US. So this shows that it's become a very important gold-producing region globally. So this explains why most gold mining companies, even the big large ones, Anglo, Newmont, Goldfields, Barrick, all have production coming from West Africa. What's differentiating Endeavour is that we've made West Africa our core focus. So we are the largest gold producer in West Africa, and this enables us to structure ourselves in a very different manner. We're able to have strong synergies with having six operations within flying distance to one another. So, next chapter, our strategy. Put simply, our goal is to have a high-quality portfolio and be a trusted partner, because if you have these two items, you're able to reward shareholders over the long term. So the new management team, I say new, I mean we joined at the end of 2015. And at the time, our mine lives were very short. We had 4 years mine life. Our cost profile was high, and we had high net debt. So the objectives that we set for ourselves was, we want to be a low-cost producer, because wherever the gold price goes, we'll be profitable. We want to have at least 10 years visibility, so that if you're an investor wanting to invest in Endeavour, there's something to invest in when you want to come out of the stock in 3, 4, 5, 10 years from now. Production size, we're not necessarily driven by production size. We've sold four assets in the last 5 years to focus on higher quality assets. However, it's important to have scale in order to have a corporate team, spread your G&A costs, and have synergies. So 1.5 million ounces is a good place to be. Most importantly, we want to be diversified across multiple assets and multiple countries, and we need to keep a strong capital discipline allocation. So to deliver this, we've been working on four pillars over the last 6 years. Be good operators, be good at building projects, unlock exploration value, and actively manage our portfolio. As I mentioned, there's right times to buy and sell assets. So our operating model, because we're solely based in West Africa, we're not managing mines with the corporate team based in Vancouver or Perth, where it takes 2 to 3 days to get to sites. We have an operating team that's based in Abidjan, a small corporate office in London, airstrips on each one of our sites, and the team is able within 1 to 3 hours to be on site. This has meant that because of this operating model being very hands-on, we've been able to meet guidance for the last 9 years, both on production and on cost. And this year is no different. You see here that for Q1, we already had over 350,000 ounces, which places us on track to achieve the top end of production guidance. And on the cost side, despite the inflationary environment, in fact, Q1, we were below our guidance range at close to $850 per ounce. The reason that we're benefiting from this environment and able to have low costs like this is, on one hand, we have a strong asset base, and the discoveries that we've made over the last 3 years have come into production, and therefore we're able to push out lower quality ounces and bring in higher quality ones. Second, we're benefiting from the devaluation of the euro. In West Africa, all the currency is pegged to the euro, and therefore, while the Australian producers or Canadians or US have experienced inflation plus an increase in their currency, we're benefiting from the currency environment. And the fuel price is regulated in country, so you never pay the spot peak gold price, which has helped a lot. On the project side, on this page, we're showing the three most advanced ones. The current priority, which was launched several months ago, is the expansion of our Sabodala Massawa mine in Senegal. This is adding a refractory circuit, which should increase production sustainably to over 400,000 ounces per year annually at very low costs. On the greenfield side, we have two in the pipeline, both of which are approaching DFS stage, which should be published later this summer. Fetekro, this was a discovery made organically. So the team spent about $20 million and within 3 years found nearly 3 million ounces. And you see on this page here that the PFS at 1500 gold price is already showing half a billion in NAV. So this is a good example of how you can create value in this space through exploration, then being able to build it and obviously produce it well. Because we didn't want to put all our eggs into the same basket, we bought Kalana back in 2017. At the time, it was the only project we had in the pipeline after ET and Houndé, which we were building. So we're advancing this to DFS stage. If I compare both of them, I'd say that Fetekro today is more an Endeavour-type project. Both are long life, low cost. However, Fetekro has the potential to produce over 200,000 ounces per year, whereas Kalana is a bit smaller. It's a bit more mining constrained, so it's about 150,000 ounces per year. So it's very good to have this competition within your portfolio, because if you just have one project, I mean, that's your one choice. Whereas for us, we have six projects in the pipeline, and we're able to compete for capital. On the exploration side, we did something very unusual when the team joined in 2016. What we saw was that many companies tell you how much they're going to spend or invest in exploration, but no one tells you what they expect to discover. So on our side, we have an operating team that's accountable for production and cost. We have a project team that's accountable for CapEx and timeline, and we have an exploration team that's accountable for how much they're going to spend, what they're going to find, and at what cost they're going to find it. So the goal we set for ourselves back in 2016 was to find over 10 million ounces at less than $25 per ounce, and late last year we were able to confirm that indeed we found over 11 million ounces. Because the first strategy was over, we announced our second target, which is more aggressive. Now it's to find up to 20 million ounces at the same cost, $25 per ounce, over the next 5 years. So in blue on this page, you see the current ounces we had last year, and in gray, those are the ounces that we expect to discover. So you see that 2/3 of those ounces come from our flagship assets, Sabodala-Massawa, Houndé, and Ity. This is probably one of my favorite slides. It's very simple, but the company strategy, in fact, we've been running the company according to these four quadrants for the last 6 years now. Put simply, the strategy has been to get assets in the bottom right box. So the bottom axis is mine life, and the right-hand axis is all-in sustaining cost, and the bubble represents the size of the production. And any assets that don't have these criteria have been divested over the last 5 years. So the assets, because I have a pointer, the assets in light blue have been divested over the last 5 years. They were short mine life, high cost. We want to focus management efforts on assets that generate healthy levels of cash flow. We then built Ity and Houndé, which appear in the middle of the screen here. And we recently acquired, over the last 2 years, we've been very busy during COVID, we bought Semafo and then Teranga. And the reason we're able to beat the M&A wave that you're seeing now is that management has been able to travel to West Africa during COVID. So while the Canadians and the Australians were restricted in their respective countries, we've been able to continue to operate. In fact, we visited the sites that we bought more than the previous management had during our due diligence phases. So this places us in a very strong position. As I mentioned, you see at the bottom of the screen here, when we joined, mine life was 4 years, now it's plus 10. Production tripled, costs remained low. This tells the same story. In gray is the production related to discontinued operations. And in blue is the production we currently have and our outlook. So you see two things. You see that we have essentially a new portfolio. So in 2017, that's Houndé. ET came on board in 2019. And then the rest is the acquisitions and the other assets that we have. Second, you see that on the outlook, our goal is to maintain costs in the $900 per ounce mark. Net debt tells a similar story. Back at the end, at mid-2019, we reached a peak net debt of $660 million after investing over $1 billion in the company to build ET and Houndé. Because we're focused on high-quality assets with quick payback periods, plus 20% IRRs at conservative gold prices, we've been able to deleverage ourselves very quick. So within 12 months, we reached a net cash position of $75 million. This was, for us, the triggering point to initiate our shareholder returns program. Because we want to be a real company, so we want to be able to find assets, find ounces, build them, produce, have a strong balance sheet, and return value to shareholders, which we're doing now. So in the last 5 quarters, we've returned close to $370 million to shareholders in the form of dividends and buybacks. So to put that into perspective, that's the equivalent of building a new mine. So this is material in terms of shareholder returns. Because we bought Teranga, we absorbed $330 million of their debt in Q1 last year. And again, despite building up the balance sheet and paying shareholder returns, we deleveraged ourselves again last year and increased our cash position to $170 million at the end of Q1, despite paying out $100 million in dividends. So what's our dividend policy? Lots of companies say it's percent of free cash flow, percent of earnings, etc., but the reality is that it's difficult to calculate. So we wanted to keep it simple. We have an outlook on production, we have an outlook on projects, exploration, and we have an outlook on our dividend policy. So what we said last year was, if the gold price is above 1500, the minimum dividend we expect to pay last year is $125 million, and we did 140. This year, the minimum is 150, and next year, minimum is 175. And of course, because the gold price has been above this, we've been able to do more. So last year, we did 140 million of dividends and roughly the same 140 million in buybacks. So what does this represent? It represents roughly $180 per ounce produced that's been returned to shareholders. So to keep it simple, we're finding ounces at $25 per ounce, we're producing them at $900 per ounce, we're reinvesting in the business, and we've returned $180 per ounce to shareholders. Other metrics to be able to compare. I know people like to invest in royalty companies, streamers. I mean, our dividend is 10%. So that's a big, that's a big royalty, in fact, that's going to our shareholders. It's 24% of our operating cash flow, nearly half of our earnings. And on the yield basis, that's about 4.6%, which is, you know, very competitive in the space. So I hope I told you a good story up until now. Why invest in Endeavour? I mean, first off, it's more a question of why invest into the gold mining sector as a whole. And obviously, we know the benefits of gold. I mean, during inflationary environments, it performs very well. But also in times of crisis, and you see the last, I mean, we put the last six crises here, but we can probably go back in time. And we always see that the gold price and gold equities performed well when there's been, you know, risk-off events. So we see on the right-hand side that Endeavour's beta is negative, which means that this provides a strong diversification in anyone's portfolio. And there's always a debate, why invest in gold, or is it better to invest in gold or gold equities? What we're seeing is that our beta versus the gold price is nearly 1.5 times. So you have strong leverage to the gold price by investing in a company such as Endeavour. Overall, we see strong potential for portfolio managers, big generalist funds, to start reallocating some of their portfolio into gold and gold equities. I mean, when the S&P is increasing every year for the last decade, you know, no one cares to diversify their portfolio, but we're starting to see now firsthand some of these investors reaching out, wanting, you know, hard assets because they've seen the tech prices decline. So interesting stat. I mean, if you take a look at the top 35 global equities and you add up all the gold sector, we would be at the bottom of this list, which shows that any small incremental change that some of these large funds start doing to rebalance their portfolios towards gold equities can have a big impact on inflows into the sector and into valuations. There's many firms pushing for this. Obviously, the World Gold Council is working towards, you know, convincing people to invest in gold and investing in gold equities. But what's interesting is that Mercer came out with a report late last year, which said that, you know, their recommendation is that fund managers should put 5% of their portfolio into gold and gold equities. Right now, it's less than 0.5%. So you can imagine the impact that this would have if all of a sudden people start to be, you know, worried about markets and want to put money into gold and gold equities. For those that like a bit of stats, we've plotted gold price versus the VanEck Gold Miners ETF price since 2013. And we're seeing the biggest disconnect we've ever seen with valuations, you know, market price valuations and the gold price. So you see the dot that's here. If that were to go back to, you know, the average, that would be at least a 30% increase. And if it goes back to the 2000 level, that's at least 50% increase in what could be a short time frame. Obviously, if you take a look at what economists are predicting, they expect the gold price to be, you know, well above 2000. What's interesting is that you've seen a very strong U.S. dollar, yet gold is holding very strong, which is a strong signal. And I only have two slides, so I'm perfect. Endeavour, what's interesting as well is that we have very strong conviction from our analysts that cover us. We have 16 buy ratings, no sell, we're very covered in the space. But more so, when you take a look at our shareholder base, we have the top 10 here, but you can go down to the top 20. We have all the usual suspects that you would see in the space. And in most cases, we are top 1, 2, or 3 holding for them, which shows very strong conviction to our stock. So, describe why invest in Endeavour in the short term. And of course, we're not here for the short term, we're here short and long term. And the way we deliver value over the long term is to have a strong, resilient business, which we have through a high quality portfolio that we build, our social license to operate, and the fact that we have a strong balance sheet. And of course, we also have strong capital discipline. We've seen our competition for capital across our projects, the fact that we're returning value to shareholders, and that we have a strong capital allocation discipline with a strong shareholder returns program. With that, I hope I'm on time and happy to take very difficult questions.
So you've referenced funds. and you've referenced the usual suspects as being loyal shareholders, but how retail investor friendly are you?
I think the best retail, you know, friendly approach you can have is to have clear, easy materials. And I hope that our materials are easy enough for any investor, whether you're a gold specialist or you used to invest in crypto and realize that maybe gold stocks are better. We hope that, you know, what we have available is good for all markets.
Many thanks. Question from the back.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. How do you manage the political risk in these ex-French colonies? I heard it from the grapevine that you have one single customer for your physical gold. Are you trying to like acquire more customers while you grow your capacity? What is the connection with those French-speaking West African countries come from? Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you for your question. Probably twofold there. The first one, the benefit of producing gold is that we don't have customers. The name of the game is to produce as much as you could at the lowest cost, and then it's sold at the market price at the refineries in Switzerland. So we don't have and we don't need to negotiate long-term contracts with other parties to sell our gold. Regarding the geopolitical, as I mentioned, I mean, all our mines are located in West Africa. Most of our management team is French-speaking. We go to sites, management reviews is once a month, so our team from London goes to sites one week every month, and when we're there, we're able to see the presidents, the ministers, etc. So the best way to build good relations, obviously, is to deliver on your promises locally, but also go regularly. Don't go, just when you have to ask for something, and that goes a long way.
Directors' interests, how do you make sure that they're aligned with shareholders? I'm sure it's all right, because you've got big guys in there that are kick you to pieces if they're not. And I have some experience on the other side of Africa. Governments can be really tricky. And even a prince not far from here managed to get a carrier bag the other day in the press. Maybe a word or two on governments and the difficulties.
Okay, so governments, and how are the directors aligned with shareholders?
Perfect, thank you. The one thing I should have mentioned is that, there's strong shareholder alignment with directors because, in fact, directors, you take La Mancha, that's a family office owned by Naguib Sawaris, who sits on our board, and our number four shareholder, who owns 6%, David Mimron, is a shareholder and also sits on our board. So at the board level, unlike other companies, we have strong shareholder representation. And they obviously want to create value for themselves, and therefore they're well aligned with the rest of the minority shareholders. At the management level as well, management has a strong stake into the company. And our CEO, if I take that as an example, he needs to hold 900% of his base salary in shares at all times, and has a five-year holding period for all his stock. So I think on the board and management side, we have very strong shareholder alignment. Regarding East Africa versus West Africa, the strong advantage we see in West Africa is that it operates as an economic union, similar to what you would see in the EU. So you have the ECOWAS region, which is a common currency, common central bank, fiscal policies that tend to be very well aligned, and arbitration courts in Paris. That means that most of the countries within this area don't want any sanctions from either the EU or from other West African countries. So this has brought some strong stability in the region. There has been, of course, some coups. They tend to be, very short. But what I mentioned before, we are the largest gold producer in the region, which means that, we met guidance the last 9 years, and we're able to withstand the different geopolitical environment because of our size and weights in the governments in which we operate. We're the largest producer in the three countries in which we operate. And you know, that's not by chance. It's a strategic decision to be important in the governments in the countries in which we operate. I hope that answers.
Thank you.
Another question here, please. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. I'm more familiar with smaller gold companies where an annual production of, say, 100,000 ounces would be considered a target. You're obviously much bigger at 1.5 million ounces a year. For new mines that you're considering, do you have a threshold in terms of minimum ounces for annual production and mine life?
Yes. Just going back. Great. So you see at the bottom here, an Endeavour type asset today is at least 200,000 ounces per year, 10 years mine life, and below $900 per ounce cost. So when you take a look at the two projects as I described earlier, both are less than $900 per ounce. They're both plus 10 years. However, as I mentioned, Fetekro is more an Endeavour style project because it's plus 200,000 ounces. Whereas Kalana is smaller at the 150 mark. And maybe just to preempt the next question, you know, we said that we actively manage our portfolio. If Kalana is not an Endeavour type asset, then you know, we're not, you know, emotionally attached to some assets. There's a right time to buy, hold, and sell, and therefore there's always the opportunity to either keep it idle in your portfolio or monetize it and be able to continue to build your balance sheet and reinvest into the business.
I didn't know if you'd been looking at my notes there, because I was going to ask you if there were any more non-core assets left to sell, because it sounds as though you don't get emotionally attached to them.
Well, I'll use more time for drinks after. Correct. So we have on the project side, as I mentioned, we have six in the pipeline. We can't obviously build everything at once, so there's always the opportunity to divest one. But you know, there's no fire sale, there's no need, so it's really, you know, opportunistic on what value you can have. And that's the same with our smaller producing assets. We're happy to have them, but you know, if someone comes knocking on the door and offers us a fair price, you know, at the end of the day, we're financially oriented people.
Thank you very much. Nice way to end. Thank you very much. Martino, Ciccio, really appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.